Hello everyone and welcome to the class of business study. So students, today we will start with chapter 3rd and this is part 1st, that is first video of chapter 3rd, and the chapter is private, public and global enterprises. Now here one more thing which I wanted to add is that global enterprises, this particular topic is being eliminated by CBSE board this year, okay? So we are not going with this particular topic, we will not study this, but at least other rest of the topics we will go with, okay? So starting with the first topic, that is private sector enterprises, the whole chapter belongs to two things, that is private and public sector enterprises. So what is private sector enterprises? The private sector consists of business owned by an individual or a group of individuals. That means this kind of firms, this kind of business or industry or enterprises are owned, that is under the ownership of, managed and controlled by a single private individual. It can be one or it can be more than one individual. The various forms of organization which comes under this kind of private sector enterprises are sole proprietorship, partnership form of business, which we have studied earlier, joint Hindu family business, cooperative societies and joint stock company. So these five forms of enterprises which are actually included in private enterprises. Now what is public sector enterprises? As the name suggests, when we say public sector enterprises, it means it is managed, owned and controls by government. Either it can be central government or either it can be state government or the combination of both. So when it comes to meaning, the public sector consists of various organizations which are owned and managed by central or state government. That means this kind of enterprises are owned and managed and control is in the hand of central, state or by both the governments, that is central and state together. The government participates in economic activity and the government is actually participating in all kind of economic activities which are done in these public sector enterprises and all throughout the country. Now features of this public sector enterprises. The first characteristics or feature is that capital is contributed by central or state government or by both under this kind of enterprises. The capital contribution is done by central or state government. Then the main motive or purpose or objective of these kind of public sector enterprises or the formation of these public sector enterprises are for public welfare, that is social welfare or social service. This is the aim. Then third is management and control are in the hands of the government. That means the full management and control are in the hands of the government. Either it can be central or state government. And it is accountable to the public. That means basically this particular firms or this particular public sector enterprises are there for giving welfare or service to the public only. So that is why they are accountable directly to the public. Then there are three forms of these public sector enterprises. This is departmental undertaking, statutory corporation and government companies. Now we will study this one by one. First starting with departmental undertakings. When, as the name suggests, when we say departmental, that means surely it is presiding certain department or it is actually related to certain department. Its function under the overall control of one department. That means these kind of departmental sector or departmental undertaking or this kind of enterprises are under the control of one ministry only, one department of the ministry, and are financed, that means the capital contribution or investment, managed and controlled by either central government or state government. It has no separate existence than government. That means this kind of departmental undertaking has no separate existence or separate entity other than government. The management, control, ownership, everything is in the hand of central or state government. For example, Indian Railways, Post and Telegraph Department, these all are under departmental undertaking. Now some features of this departmental undertaking, it has no separate legal entity or existence other than government. Second is finance, that means its finance is done by annual budget allocation of the government. That means when in the parliament the budget is being announced, during that annual budget all the funds are allocated from the government only and all its earnings go to government treasury. That means the finance is done by government only through the annual budget when it is declared, and whatever amount which is contributed or whatever amount of profit which is being occupied by this particular department undertakings are go to the government treasury, that is in the form of revenue of the government. Then third is accounting and audit. the government rules relating to audit and accounting are applicable to it. That means whatever rules which are formed or framed by the government related to checking the accounts, that is auditing, and everything is done according to the government rules or framework only. Then staffing, it's employees. Staffing here means whomsoever the employees which you have been, which you are appointing or assigning for doing certain job in these departmental undertakings. So the staff or the employees are government employees. That means whatever staff or whatever employees who are working under departmental undertaking, all are from government employees only and are recruited and appointed as per the government. That means their recruitment, they are called by the government as per the government rules only, and they are appointed by the government procedure only. And all of these employees are called as government employees. Then accountability, these are accountable to the concerned ministry. That means all these employees and all this department are accountable and directly answerable and responsible to the one ministry, that is government, either central or state. Now there are some merits of this departmental undertaking. The first is effective control. That means this kind of department undertaking has effective control, very good control, as it is more effective in achieving the objective laid down by government, as it is under the direct control of the government. That means when this departmental undertaking are formed, it is managed, controlled, and ownership under the government only. So whatever rules and regulation, whatever aims which are laid down by the government only, so it is very easy and effective way to control the firms. Then public revenue, it is a source of government income, as it is revenue goes to government treasury. That means whatever is being benefited, whatever is being gained or collected in the form of profit of these particular public sector enterprises or departmental undertakings goes to directly to government treasury, and which is a good source of government's income, or we can call it revenue of the government. Third is optimum utilization of funds. That means there is no wastage. Better utilization of funds can be done in this, and funds here means money. It is accountable to Parliament for all its action. That means, as I said, that as the annual budget being declared, during that time only whatever funds, finance which is being judged and all the decisions related to that will be taken in the Parliament only. So they are directly accountable or answerable to Parliament, to the ministry or officials. So all its actions which ensures proper utilization of funds, and for all their actions, whatever they are doing, whatever activities they are doing in such kind of departmental undertakings, they are always answerable to the top minister officials in the Parliament. So proper utilization can be done of funds. Then fourth is secrecy. It is suitable for activities where secrecy and strict control is required, like defense. That means these kind of enterprises are better suitable for those work or for those activities where confidentiality should be maintained or secrecy could be maintained. For example, defense, that is Air Force, Army and Navy. Now, so there are some demerits of this departmental or disadvantages of departmental undertaking. First is inflexibility. It suffers from why inflexibility? Because they are not getting a good autonomy or freedom to take decisions, because majorly all the decisions, management, control is in the hands of government only. So they are, these officials or these employees who are working under this departmental undertaking, they have not got any freedom to make their own decisions. So it suffers from interference from minister and top officials and in their working. That means whatever they are doing on day-to-day basis, their decision making, rules, regulation, procedure, everything is being decided by the ministers or top officials only. So there is continuous interference of these ministers or officials in their day-to-day working. So this reduces the flexibility, and because of this, it reduces their flexibility and efficiency to do the work properly. And it lacks flexibility, which is essential, and because of this, it is lacking with flexibility. That means they have not got enough freedom to make their or change the decisions, okay, which are framed already by government. So it hampered the smooth running of the business. Second is red tapism and bureaucracy. It suffers from red tapism in day-to-day work, which result in delay. That is a lot of corruptions and a lot of things which are taking place, so which results in delay in decision, and because of lot of interference from top officials, so decisions are being delayed, okay, for a long time and due to too many formalities, and there is a lot of legal formalities involved in such kind of departmental undertaking. Why? Because they need to prepare, they need to give all the evidence and proof of their activities to the, they have to show this to top management officials. And that is why it is very, very important to make evidence, to have all legal formalities completely done. But because of this, these legal formalities, which are a lot of legal formalities they need to finish, and because of this, decisions are delayed, lot of paperwork, lot of procedures they need to complete. So this is one of the disadvantage. Then fourth is, this organization are usually insensitive to consumers' needs and do not provide good and adequate service to them. That means these kind of enterprises do not take care actually of consumers. Why? Because they are more answerable to top management officials. Lot of interference is there from the government officials in this kind of departmental undertakings, and that is why they do not have good time or enough time to take care of consumers' grievances. So they are not considering and they are very insensitive towards consumers' needs, requirements, and do not provide better goods or adequate goods to complete their needs. Then fifth is, such organizations are managed by civil servant. As I said, that all the employees who are working in such kind of organizations are government employees, or we can call them civil servants and government officials, who may not have the necessary expertise. May be possible they do not acquire professional qualifications, professional skills, okay, they are not very creative, very well qualified, and do not have much experience in this management work. So because of that, it hampers the growth and development of such kind of undertakings. Now, where this kind of departmental undertaking is suitable, after finishing features, advantage and disadvantage, that means this kind of undertaking is suitable for which field. So it is better suitable where full government control is needed. That means all those areas, all those enterprises, all those activities where full interference of government is there or government control is there, in such areas this departmental undertaking is very good, very suitable. For example, defense, basically, where huge investment is involved, like aircraft or iron and steel. So these kind of industries where lot of interference of government is there, lot of investment or huge investment is required, so in such kind of industry or enterprises, this kind of departmental undertaking is very much suitable. Then undertaking is a source of revenue, and along with that, this undertaking or this departmental undertaking is working just for the sake of the collection of revenue for the government. That is, they are actually majorly responsible for government's income, like railways. Then second form of public sector enterprises after departmental undertaking is statutory corporation. Now basically, this kind of corporation is established under a special act passed in the parliament. Again, there is a lot of interference of central or state government in this kind of statutory corporation also. And these are under a special act in the parliament which is passed, and with that act only this kind of enterprises or this kind of corporations are formed basically. Its objective, power and functions are clearly defined in the special act, and whatever act which is passed in the parliament for forming this kind of enterprises, so all the rules, regulations, the working pattern, everything is pre-decided in this kind of special act of legislature. Example is UTI, that is Unit Trust of India, Life Insurance Corporation. So all these are examples of statutory corporation. Now moving to features of this statutory corporations. It is established under a special act which defines its objective, power and function. That means whatever objective or aim with which this kind of corporations are formed, and whatever powers and functions which are pre-decided in this kind of special act. Okay. Then it has a separate legal existence. Its management is vested in a board of directors appointed or committed by government. That means the government is actually taking care of these enterprises, and they are forming a board of directors committee or a team, and these team or these board of directors are supposed to take care of the functions, the activities of this particular statutory corporations. It has its own staff. That means the board of directors is then selecting its own staff, recruited and appointed as per the provision of the that particular act which is passed in the parliament. So whatever staffing work, powers, functions, objectives, everything is decided by the that particular special act which is passed in the by the government official in the parliament. This type of enterprises is usually independently financed. That means this kind of enterprises is financed independently and it obtains funds by borrowing from government. Again, borrowing is done from government only for this firm or from public through earnings. It is not subject to same accounting and audit rules which are applicable to government department. But one difference is there. So this particular thing, all the accounting and audit work is not exactly same whatever is done in the government company. Now there are some advantages or merits of this government statutory corporation. First is administrative autonomy. When we say autonomy means freedom, okay. So it can be easily formed as per the provision of company. That means formation of such kind of statutory corporation through a special act. So it is very easy to form as per the Companies Act. Only an executive decision of government is required. That means only thing is required is an executive's decision on this particular formation of this company which is required. And after that you can continue with this kind of corporation. Second is greater flexibility. That means a greater autonomy, or it can enjoy autonomy in management decisions and flexibility in day-to-day working. Lot of government interference is not there actually. Okay, so they can enjoy a good freedom or autonomy in their day-to-day routine work. Then efficient staff. The government company can have their own rules and regulations regarding staffing. So they can appoint specialized people, professional people, skillful people who are expertise in their own field. So they have better quality people or efficient employees in their firms who are professional in their work. But there are certain disadvantages of this department, that is corporation is. First is autonomy on paper only. As we discussed the same point in the merits or advantages, that they've got full autonomy or full freedom. But practically speaking, that means when we see it actually, so this autonomy is only on paper only. There is a lot of interference of government, ministries or officials. So it suffers from interference from government officials, ministers and even politicians. So because of that, they lack or they reduce the freedom which is to be enjoyed. Second is political interference. It evades constitutional responsibility which a company financed by the government should have, as it is not directly answerable to parliament. That means they are not directly actually answerable to parliament, but they are answerable to politicians. And it evades constitutional responsibility, and because of this their constitutional responsibility, that is the politicians, they need to take care of. So the company which is financed by government need to be taken care by the government only. So lot of political interference is there. They are accountable to lot of political people. So this reduces their expansion, development, their freedom and flexibility. So this is also one of the disadvantage. Then third is board packed with government representative. That means whatever in the parliament, whenever they are assigning a board of directors as a committee member who are taking care of all the activities of these statutory corporation, but all those people who are there or members who are there in board of directors, all are government representatives only. So they are working according to government norms only. So the board usually consists of the politicians. That means in this board of director usually what kind of people are there? They are not professional people. They are political people from political backgrounds. Civil servants also are there who are interested more in pleasing their political bosses. That means all those officials who are, or all those members who are there in board of directors, are government representative only. And whatever work they are doing, they are just to please the political people only. For their sake, for their betterment only they are doing. So all are political bosses, then in efficient operation of the company, and that is why it lacks the efficient operation of the company. Now for in which field this particular statutory corporation are suitable. So where the private sector is also needed along with the government sector, private and government sector, both interference is there. In such kind of enterprises this statutory corporation is better suitable. And second, where activities related to finance are to be encouraged. That means all those activities which is related to finance, wherever it is encouraged, in such kind of enterprises this statutory corporation is suitable. Now next topic is changing role of public sector. That means what are actually the changing role of the public sector Public sector in India was created to achieve two types of objective. That means these public sector are actually formed in India for two objectives, basically to speed up the economic growth of the country. That means just to have expansion, to speed up the growth of the country, and to achieve a more equitable distribution of income and wealth. That means, and again, for good distribution of income and wealth to all the people, no matter they are in towns or no matter they are in backward or rural areas. So each and every person must get equal distribution of income as well as wealth. So for this purpose, this public sector enterprise has been formed. The role and importance of this public sector has changed with time, but due to changes in time and with time, these public sector, their aims, objectives, their functions and activities are having a lot of changes, and its role over a period of time can be summarized as the first purpose or first aim or objective of this public sector enterprises, or importance or role of public sector enterprises. First is development of infrastructure. When we say infrastructure, means roads, railways, transportation, communication. These are actually infrastructure which make out a particular area better developed, growth can be accessed. At the time of independence, India suffered from acute shortage of heavy industry. That means when at the time of independence, 1947 time period, we were having very few industries, and we don't have any heavy industries as such as engineering, iron and steel, oil refineries, heavy machinery, etc. So because of shortage of such kind of heavy industries, huge investment requirement was there, and a long gestation period. Gestation period means development period. A long time is required for the development of these kind of industry, which requires huge investment, and private sector was not willing to enter into this area. And that time, private individuals or private sector enterprises are not taken any initiative to start with these kind of industry. There was only public sector enterprises. So the duty of development of basic infrastructure, providing infrastructure facilities means roads, railways, dams, canals, transportation, communication. So the duty of development of these infrastructure was assigned only to public sector, and which is it discharged very effectively. That means this public sector enterprise did lot of contribution, did lot of efforts to have this infrastructure properly. Second is regional balance. When we say regional balance, means regional means region, okay, an area which has been the all over country. If we see, we have been divided into various towns and cities and rural areas, villages. So there is lot of differences between a town and a rural village, okay, because of infrastructure. The differences can be of infrastructure, that the towns and cities have good roads, railways, all facilities are provided, whereas in small villages they don't acquire such kind of facilities. So regional imbalances system was there. So to have regional balance, this kind of public sector have make an important role. Earlier, most of the development was limited to few areas like towns and cities only, for providing employment to the people and for accelerating. When we say accelerating, means to increase the growth, increase the employment facilities, infrastructure facilities. So to have better growth and expansion of all these infrastructure facilities, this public sector enterprises were doing lot of efforts, especially in the backward or rural areas. Many industries were set up by public sector in those areas, because that time, third is economies of scale. In certain industries like electric power plants, natural gas, petroleum, etc., these kind of industries where economies of scale which is required, that is huge capital or huge investment is required, and large base are required to function in these particular industries or areas economically. So such areas which are taken up by the public sector enterprise, that means public sector enterprises took initiative to start or to form such kind of industries where huge investment is required, proper management and control is required, because that time private sector was not in the picture. Fourth is control of monopoly and restrictive trade practices. Now, this is MRTP Act basically. These enterprises were also established to provide competition to private sector. That time there was no private sector enterprises, but still very few have started to take initiative in this kind of industries. So just to compete or just to give a competition to private sector enterprises and to check their monopolies and restrictive trade practices, this public sector enterprises, with that good intention, they have been formed just to reduce these restrictive trade practices. Fifth is import substitution. Public enterprises were also engaged in production of capital equipments which were earlier imported from other countries. That means some kind of equipments which were they were engaged in production of capital equipment. Now capital equipments here means machineries, okay, which are required for the process of production of converting raw material into final goods. So these capital equipments which were earlier imported from other countries, now the public sector undertakings who are taken initiative to produce these kind of capital equipments. So this is all about today's video. Dear students, we will meet again with some new topics and rest of the topics in the next video. Till then, thank you, goodbye.